Hello, Dr. Sushma Singh, this side. Today in Unit 1, Social Background of the Emergence of Sociology in India, we are going to start this lecture with topic Responses and Reactions of the Indian Intellectuals. A close scrutiny of the records of the association and societies mentioned above and the writings of the native intellectual reveals several interesting trends. A small section of the Indian intellectuals were completely overwhelmed by the West. A few, on the contrary, were drawn to the traditional heritage. Social reformers like Ram Mohan, Ishwar Chandra Vidyasagar or Jyotiba Phule wanted to change the existing social institutions for a more human conditions. However, nearly all recognized the necessity and desirability of understanding the social situation. The question with many was neither of uncritical acceptance nor of blind rejection of the elements and the ideas of the West. Those like Bankim Chandra and particularly Bhudev sought to reinterpret tradition and challenge the Western interpretation of the Indian society, which presented Indian not as subjects but the objects. A little later, Brijendranath Seel and Binoy Kumar Sarkar took up the same threads. In the case of the former, one witnesses a critical and discursive response to the comparative evolutionary treatment of various societies and cultures, including that of the India, by the British social anthropologist and the sociologist, which often reflected not only the wrong premises in their treatment of other cultures of society, but also carried unjustifiable values. Seel refuted attempts to interpret Indian social and cultural reality from a reductionist, unlinear evolutionary frame of reference. Sarkar wrote extensively in response to the writing of the European Indologist and sociologist, in whose writing one could clearly find the biases of the Orientalist frame of reference that depicted the Hindus or Indians to be otherworldly or the pacifist. Particularly the contributions of Max Müller and Max Weber on Hinduism and the culture and social structure of the Indian came under his severe criticism. Similarly, many other social scientists such as S.V. Ketkar, A.R. Wadia, K.P. Chattopadhyay, Bhupendranath Datta and N.K. Bose created through their writings the ambience for teaching and research in society and social anthropology in this country. Their writings and activities shared in common the consciousness of the historicity of the Indian civilization and its distinct social and cultural identity, which was denied the centrality it deserved in the most of the Western scholars, whether Indologist or sociologist. The writing of these early social scientists have a very strong conscientizing effect on the Indian academics and intellectuals to provide legitimacy to teaching and research in sociology. The discovery of India's past and of the antiquity, richness and versatility of its heritage gave self-confidence to the elite and the material necessity for national myth-making. The criticism of Hinduism by European missionaries and conversion of poor and lowly Hindu as well as the tribal people into Christianity wiped up the nationalist sentiments of the new elites. there was an urge for social and religious reform, a reinterpretation of the past, an assertion of identity, and an examination of the present. The ground was being prepared for the emergence of society. Now let us move to the next point, early sociological beginnings. Karl Marx and Max Weber, as well as the Durkheim, depended on British and continental writing on India for their analysis of Indian society and culture. Reber's study, the Todas, was based on intensive field work and was the first monograph on a people of India in the modern anthropological tradition. Two of his students, G.S. Gurye and K.P. Chattopadhyay, came to play a significant role in the development of sociology and anthropology in India. Reber's study was followed by A.R. Radcliffe Brown's study, The Andaman Islanders. During the first two decades, two Indian scholars, L.K. Anant Raksha Iyer and S.K. Roy, made their mark in anthropology, though both of them lacked any formal training in the discipline. In addition to his research work among the tribes of Bihar, Roy founded and edited the famous journal Man in India. Iyer, on the basis of his anthropological writing, was appointed to the lectureship in ethnography in Calcutta University, which paved the way for his first university department of anthropology in India. The efforts of Brijendranath Seel for the introduction of the discipline of the sociology in Indian university deserve special mention. As a professor of philosophy at Calcutta University, Seel wrote, lectured, and initiated studies on what he called comparative sociology. He undertook a comparative study of Vaishnavism and wrote a paper on race, origin, and the treatise on the positive sciences of ancient Hindu. He argued that social development was multilinear and judgments regarding the superiority or inferiority of social customs and institutions hardly made any sense. He observed that social institutions could be properly studied only in the context of race, religion, and culture. As Vice Chancellor of Mysore University, in 1914, Seel, along with A.R. Wadia, was instrumental in introducing social philosophy and sociology there. Seel also had a hand in the beginning of study in sociology in Calcutta University in 1907. Binoy Kumar Sarkar and the Radha Kamal Mukherjee, both of whom were disciple of Seel, taught the subject, though there was no separate department of sociology there. Indeed, the recognition of sociology as a separate academic discipline came much later than, say, economics or political science in Indian universities. Here we want to close this lecture. Thanks for listening.